we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day, recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardness, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join me with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and as an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me, in the faith and in the love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted in you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Eternal One, who was, and is, and is to come. Amen. Between the recent school shooting in Oakland, the suicide bombing of an educational center in Afghanistan, the escalation of aggression by Russian leadership against Ukraine, not to mention the ravages of Hurricane Ian on the heels of Hurricane Fiona's devastation, there has been more violence and suffering than our world can bear, even when we fall to our knees in prayer. Today, I find myself deeply grateful for that prophet most of us have heard precious little about, Habakkuk, whose potent words of lament and protest seems to touch the anguish of my own soul, seeing all that is not well within our world. Violence, strife, contention, destruction, his ancient words mirror our present reality. Habakkuk's voice is one among the Book of the Twelve, a grouping of the shorter prophetic texts in the Hebrew Bible. And even for his relative obscurity, Habakkuk's mighty witness in our scriptural canon is a gift. For the prophet demonstrates that we do not need to be afraid to speak frankly with God from the depths of our lived experience. This is good news for all of us, and perhaps especially for the prophets among our midst, whose voices the church often finds tricky to hear. Faith, after all, dares us to be honest and courageous. Taking the risk to speak the truth orients our hearts in that Godward direction toward which faith always seeks to move us. The divine vision for a transformed world where injustice, idolatry, and corruption are no more is that blessed future for which Habakkuk eagerly awaits, straining like a watchman to see God's salvation at hand. It is the divine dream for which we also watch and pray, not only every Sunday in our prayer for mission, but from generation to generation. For we know the reign of God brings justice and joy, as love's power transforms all things. This is the future Habakkuk is instructed to write on tablets so that it can be shared abroad as inspiration to the righteous, who God says shall live by faith, even unto the vision's appointed time. Before these COVID times, I had opportunity to visit the Atlanta History Center during my years living there, and I got to participate in a simulation of the historic Freedom Rides, those legendary interracial bus rides launched by student activists traveling between Washington, D.C. and Mississippi to challenge segregation on interstate buses and bus terminals. I had no idea what I was signing up for in that experience. Even through prior visits to Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture did not prepare me for the intensity of imagining stepping back into that time in history as part of a cohort from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee undertaking such dangerous and daring rides. These rides, combined with boycotts and sit-ins backed by the National Christian Leadership Conference, garnered national media attention and forced the hand of federal officials to implement and hold accountable the states for policy changes that aligned with Supreme Court decisions taken in the 1960s. Only when the Interstate Commerce Commission officially banned segregation in all facilities under its jurisdiction did those segregated tendencies finally come to an end. Ella Baker was a significant organizer in this era. Her instrumental efforts in the struggle for civil rights developed young leaders in the student protest movement. She saw their initiative and courage and identified with their prophetic struggle. our world to think about the root causes of racialized oppression and to work effectively together toward societal transformation. Baker herself had grown up hearing stories of her grandmother's lived experience, a woman who had been whipped for refusing to marry the person that her enslaver picked out for her. Surely Baker must have known that precious cost of walking by faith one slow step at a time into a long-awaited future while watching with the prophets of every era for love's power to recreate our world. October is the appointed time for reflecting on stewardship at St. Paul's, a season in our communal life where we prayerfully engage that charge that the Apostle Paul issued to Timothy that we heard lifted up in today's epistle reading, where we are invited to consider, alongside Timothy, that treasure of faith entrusted to us by our mothers and grandmothers and grandparents from generations past, the treasure of faith that we too can choose to cultivate for the sake of love, now and for future generations. This past week was also the appointed date for our diocesan clergy retreat up at Bishop's Ranch, and I had no idea that this retreat would nudge me to consider how we are called as people of faith to engage the pain of our world as a sacred responsibility, perhaps even an opportunity to practice our call as stewards of this future that God has appointed for the world. It might sound strange to start stewardship season as we think about this annual journey of discerning how God calls us to participate in the life of this church and the life of the world as people of faith, pledging our time, energy, and financial resources to steward this life we share in Christ. But Joanna Macy's The Work That Reconnects provided the foundation of our retreat time. And one of her sacred practices is something called honoring our pain for the world. As we engaged with this ancient practice of bearing witness to particular realities in our world that we carry in our hearts, that we hold before God in our prayers, that we pray with and wrestle with as we contemplate our own works of mercy and solidarity, we got to hear many stories of suffering, grief, and loss in those conversations. Stories of experiences known in our lives, in the lives of those we love. Stories that involve indeed all creaturely beings alive on this planet in this time. And in the sharing of those stories, I found myself overwhelmed with gratitude, with a tender compassion of our Creator who surrounds us and our world is saving grace. This love strengthens and renews the unity we are made to know as people who long to be redeemed by love's healing power. This is the perfect love which raised Jesus from the dead. It is the force that animates our life together as God's goodness renews and recreates us all. Love is the communal treasure that we cherish. St. Paul's is a sacred refuge for us and for many in seasons where we are overwhelmed by personal grief, loss, and pain. It's also a place where we strengthen our commitment and courage to serve our surrounding community and indeed the wider world through the love Christ commissions us to share. The global circumstances around us may seem to resist God's dream for humanity. Habakkuk yet reassures us that divine promises never lie. God's reign of justice and joy will transform the world. Though it tarry, together we will wait for this promised redemption, even as we summon communal courage to love fiercely in word and deed, daring to be counted among the righteous who shall live by faith. Amen. the breaking of the bread and in the prayers. We persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord. We proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. We seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself. Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we thank you for labors of love expressed in our community through the Circle of St. Paul's. Especially at this time of the Circle's annual rummage sale, we ask you to uphold their ministry of friendship and care through your faithful strength. Inspire us by their witness that embraces neighbors near and far. Help us all to channel your unfailing provision in our lives and to embrace your call to be people of patience, generosity, and joy. For with you, nothing is ever wasted. Your purposes are everlasting, and your treasures endure from generation to generation.
Amen.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Brock, Leslie Benino, Sharon B., Taiana Faave, Ann George, Ruth Haynes, Lori Lawson, Larry Margolis, Stephanie Medina, Dare Mikos, John Miller, George Simon, Riley Volpe, people of Ukraine, people of Russia, people of Afghanistan, people of Mexico, people of Puerto Rico, people of Florida. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us say our prayer for mission together. Gracious and loving God,
help us this day to understand and celebrate your dream for the world, to be transformed.
Amen. Dear friends in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Can we have a round of applause, please? Being part of St. Paul's Witness to Love, and know that we continue to hold you in our hearts and pray for you in your respective journeys. So let us all continue to walk in that love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love that came to be with us, to show us what it is to be truly human, and to offer that back to God as a sacrifice that is a blessing to the whole world.
I'm trusting the Lord.
though we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Our Father, who art